not God. God has the right to do whatever he wants because he is sovereign. But if what John says is true, that God is love, then God will do nothing that's not love. And the kind of love that God has is not the kind of love that I have.
No.
Right?
Right.
The kind of love that God has is the kind of love that I aspire to have.
Amen.
The kind of love that God has is the kind of love that only God can give and put inside of me. That is what the work of the Holy Spirit is for.
Amen.
Amen.
Is to give me agape love. Godly love. I cannot manufacture it. I can't make it. I can't keep it. I'm my own self. I can only have it as God puts it in me. The love of God.
Yeah.
That God is love, right?
Right?
Okay, so I put my glasses somewhere. I have no idea where I put them. That's why I got ready to read that last verse. This is why I always keep a spare pair. Yeah, they're in here somewhere, and it probably is kind of in my coat pocket, but I got seven of them. You guess which one. Okay, Ray, you read 12, for the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Do you believe that one?
Yes.
Do you see it happening in our world today?
Yes.
No, thank you. This world, evil seems to run rampant.
It sure does.
So how do you interpret that last verse? It's there. You either read over it, or you figure out it means something. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Any ideas? Are you going to just leave me up here to this one?
No, I think that this thing obviously has to play out. The Lord has to allow a certain amount of evil to do its, to have its hand, so to speak, because to finish all righteousness, this thing has to close up. And
so when you read a verse like that, what you're able to see is that God looks at this not through our eyes, which are eyes of mortality, but he sees it through the eyes of eternity.
Amen.
Right? There will come a day when God will pay back all those who've committed evil. Right?
Amen.
Would you have your hand up?
Yes. I go back to Leviticus chapter 26.
Okay.
Because he's talking about his statutes and those that despise his statutes. And in verse 17, he said, if you don't, if you despise my statutes, I will set my face against you. You shall be slain before your enemies. They that hate you shall reign over you, and you shall flee when none pursueth you.
Mm. It's a strong verse. Now listen, that happens in this life. Okay, you've seen it in history. The enemies of God have come to nothing. And their families and their followers have come to nothing, and yet evil still is prevalent. You guys had your hands up. Ricky?
Go ahead. You continue the Sabbath school lesson in Proverbs 5, verse 21. For the ways of the man are before the eyes of the Lord, and he pondereth all his goings. His own iniquities shall take the wicked himself, and he shall be holden with his cords of sin. He shall die without instruction. And in the greatness of his folly, he shall go astray.
Mm, good verse as well. So listen, this is why I asked you if you believe that God interacts with your day-to-day life. Because if he interacts with your day-to-day life, you, the righteous, then he also will interact in the day-to-day life of his enemies. Right, Ricky, you had your hand up?
Yeah, Romans chapter 1 talks about how the wrath of God. And the wrath of God in Romans chapter 1 is he has separated himself. And what happens when God separates is evil comes in. Right?
Very well said. Very well said. that happens as well today. The problem is that the world doesn't know Romans chapter 1. And the world looks to God and blames him for that evil.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But listen, it's not only the world. Sometimes we as Christians blame God as well. Because we do not understand. God says, my ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts. But what he asks you to do is to trust him and to know that he is love. And if God is love, then he will take everything that happens to you and work it out for good, for those who love him. Right? Okay, so verse 13. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? You got to love what Peter writes here. Who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are what? Now listen. When Peter writes that verse, he's not confused. What he's doing is he's dealing with the reality of life on this earth. The Bible says, if God is for you, what? And that's what Peter is saying in that first verse. Right? But he also realizes that if you follow God, and if you set your heart for righteousness, you will suffer tribulation. Because you will set yourself against the ways of this world. And the world will hate you. And you know what happens then, right? What Peter is saying is that when you come to Christ and you come as a little child, you have a certain understanding of God that's not mature. Right? And some of us come to Christ thinking, man, I've given my heart to Christ, now my life is going to be roses from now until Jesus comes back. Everything will be great, there will be no more problems, no more trials, no more tribulations. And you have to grow up in Christ, right? And you realize that Jesus said, it's not that way. If you follow me, you will have persecutions and trials and tribulations. The world hates me. They will hate you as well. But Peter says, listen, nothing, and Paul backs this up, that nothing that you suffer in this life, nothing you suffer. Paul said, I am convinced that these momentary tribulations. Now, if anybody had trials and tribulations, it was Paul.
Yeah.
Right? And he looked and said, these things are just momentary. Because Paul had the eyes of eternity. And that's what you have to mature into. Having the eyes of eternity. That no matter what you're suffering today, it's going to come and it's going to pass. Okay? You live 100 years. What's 100 years compared to a million years? What's a million years compared to a billion years? And what's a billion compared to a trillion? How long comes after that?
1 billion.
But eternal life will last past a trillion years. So all the suffering that you suffer here is but for a very short period of time compared to the joy and the glory of eternity. Right? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. Do not be afraid of their threats, nor be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Now, how do you sanctify the Lord God in your heart? Any ideas?
Believe in him.
Believe in him? Very good. Very well said.
Appreciate him.
Appreciate him?
Be completely settled that Father always knows best, regardless of what you think or feel.
Okay, did I hear somebody say become like?
Be God-like.
Be God-like? I like that. How do you sanctify God in your heart?
You got to keep your heart clean because the Lord will not dwell there if your heart is not clean. So to have a clean heart means to have Christ dwelling.
So again, it comes back to your relationship, right? That you have a living relationship with the living God, that he actually dwells inside of you. How do you sanctify God in your heart? It's by what you guys said. By having a living relationship with him That way he changes you to become more Christ-like. He sanctifies you. He cleanses you. Let me tell you something. You want to live like that, the world will hate you.
Oh, yeah.
He does for us what we can't do it for ourselves.
Amen. Amen. Sanctify the Lord God, this is verse 15, in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the what? That is in you, with meekness and fear. Do you guys, are you able to give a defense for the hope that's inside of you?
Yes.
Now listen, we live in 2015. Some of us, life's really good. Some of us, life's okay. Some of us, life stinks. But for those of us where life stinks, it's nothing compared to a stinky life back in Christ's day. Okay? Or go to a third world country where there is no hope. The worst thing to happen to a human being is to lose all hope. And this is why Christ, in the life of Jesus, is such a powerful draw to the people of this world. Because if you have no hope, he gives you hope. If you're living in darkness, he gives you light. He will give you what you cannot get from this world. And it can last you all the days of your life. Ricky?
The people in the third world countries are, to me, are closer to Christ because that is their only hope.
Yes. Very well said. Very well said. Verse 16, having a good conscience, that when they defame you as what? Those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. For it is better if it is the will of God to suffer for doing good than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he went in. Let me hear you guys explain this one. By whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison, who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight souls, were saved through the water. What? Up until those set of verses, I understood everything that Peter said. And he goes with this line of thinking that we just read. And now he's talking about, you know, preaching to the spirits in prison. Then he goes all the way back to life before the flood. It's like, what?
He said it. It's that line of thinking that preaches to that.
So, by whom, verse 19, he also went now. Who is the he?
Christ.
He's capitalized, right? Okay, so the verse before that, he talks about Christ. Christ suffering once, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, by whom also he, that is Christ, went and preached to the spirits in prison, who were formerly disobedient. Who are these spirits in prison? Now, if I was a Baptist, I would tell you that when Jesus died, he went to hell. He preached to all those people in hell. But they never tell you if he brought those people out of hell. Tell me, have you ever heard a Baptist tell you? Because I asked him. Well, if he went there, did he bring anybody back? What was the purpose of going there? And we just look at each other and go on to a different subject. Who are these spirits that were in prison that he preached to?
I think of the ones that had died before Christ, and he went to preach the gospel so that all would receive the gospel.
He preached that at his death? See, I bring this to you to let you understand that there are certain things in Scripture that are hard to understand.
Yes.
And you wonder and you ask yourself, dude, you couldn't have wrote it in a much clearer way? I mean, seriously? But God had a reason for it, right?
Yes.
Is it burning you, Ray?
No, of course.
No, I'm done. Because I'm waiting to see if one of you guys have a better explanation than what I have.
You
When Christ died on the cross, the evil angel and the devil, they threw the biggest party, thought they had won it all. Right?
Okay.
He came to show them that their fate was sealed. When he came back from the grave, that was it. They were done.
None?
Finished.
Okay.
That's who he preached to. Just his showing up let them know that he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords.
Okay. Now, you look at that verse, and you go into the next verse, and it brings you back to where?
Noah.
This is key to understanding what's being talked about here. Right? The antediluvians. Was Christ around in their day in the flesh?
No, in the flesh.
Right. Now, how were they saved?
Looking forward.
They were saved through faith. The same way you and I are saved today, right? Because there is only one mediator between God and man. There's only one name under heaven given to man whereby we can be saved. That wasn't just given to everybody prior to Jesus' birth and death. You had a lot of people that lived before that, right? How were they saved? The same way. By a Savior who was, as you said, to come, who would give his life, a ransom for many, who would sacrifice himself, the just for the unjust. And they had to look forward in faith. So when Christ died, it was that spirit, that mind that was in Christ that took him to the cross, that Noah had. That Noah preached to the people for how many years?
120
years. Flood's coming. God is going to end this wickedness. All you have to do is believe.
Amen.
Come in. The ark of safety. Be saved. That spirit was preaching to them. It was the same spirit of Christ, right?
Yeah.
So you understand, this verse has been misapplied, misquoted, and misunderstood for a long period of time. Okay? Again, if Jesus went into hell and preached to those people in hell, what was the reason for it? He didn't bring any of them back with him. And if they were in hell, and God condemned them down there, because who's in charge of hell? God or the devil? No, God. The devil isn't in charge of anything. You guys understand that, right? The devil isn't in charge of hell. God is. God is the one who sends people there, right? So if God sent them to hell and said, you deserve to be here, then Jesus came and preached to them, then God was wrong. And God can't be wrong. You understand that line of thought?
Yeah.
My Baptist friends have a hard time with that line of thought. They look at me and eventually, like I said, we just look at each other and we just shake our heads. They think I'm crazy. And we go on to something else. Yeah, thank you. So, it is the Spirit of Christ, the same Spirit that Christ promises to give to you. He gave to them as well. The Spirit of redemption.
Well,
yes, Ricky.
There's a lot of meaning in that verse. It says that Christ was slain from the foundation of the world.
The
cross is only the revelation.
Yes. Yes. Listen, this is why Paul says this has been a mystery hidden in past ages, but have now is made manifest to us today. Okay? The mystery of the cross. Those of you who are thinking, yes, I'm going to close here very soon.
All day,
right. By whom also he went and preached to the spirits in prison who formerly were disobedient when once the divine long-suffering waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, 8 souls were saved through the water. There is also an antitype which now saves us. What is that antitype? Now, what does baptism have to do with Noah and the flood? God cleansed the world in Noah's day through water, and God is going to cleanse you now through water, the water of baptism. Okay? He preached to those people back then. The spirits who were disobedient were cleansed by water. Right? You understand what Peter's talking about? Now, who said he was a stupid fisherman?
Right.
Because for 2,000 years, we haven't understood what this humble fisherman put down in writing. It's like, there's a lot of things that they write in here. It's like, when I get to see you, it's like, really? Come on. Okay. So, by whom also, though we went through all that. Verse 21. There's also an antitype which now saves us. Ooh, see? My Baptist friends. Baptism is part of your salvation. Because it says right there. There is also an antitype which now saves us. What is that antitype? Not the removal of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience towards God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So, are you saved by baptism?
No.
That's a what?
A step, a declaration.
It says it right there, but we are saved.
It's an outward appearance of what's going on.
So do you understand why you have to take the Bible and read it deeply, not just skim over it? And you have to take this verse with all the other verses that deal with salvation and baptism and come to a conclusion. This is why I joined the Adventist Church, because when I found out the history of the Adventist Church, this is how the founders of this church came to their understanding of doctrine. Because they took the Bible, and they took a verse, and they took another verse on that subject, and another verse, and another verse. And do you know that I've been told from somebody that used to come here that that's not the way you should actually preach or put your sermons together? That was done in the past, and we don't do that no more.
What do we do?
That's what I said. What do we do? That's how we change the fundamentals of the church. Understand that?
But the Bible says itself.
Here, there, yes.
Line upon line, precept.
And this is why I'm still an Adventist today, because I have not found another church that teaches the Scriptures as clearly as the Adventist Church. That they take everything on that subject and look at it as a whole, not just one individual text. Okay? So there's also an antitype which now saves us. That antitype is baptism. It's not the baptism that saves us, it's the antitype of Christ. Was Christ baptized?
Yes.
Did he need to be baptized?
No.
Why was he baptized? So that all righteousness may be fulfilled, right? And so he was baptized to give us an example of what we need to do. You're not saved through baptism, you're saved through Christ, the author of the baptism, right? Does that make sense? Okay. I'm wanting to get through this chapter. So, only one more verse left, so we're good. Verse 22. Who has gone into heaven and is where? At the right hand of God. Angels and authorities and powers having been made what? Subject to him. Here's a question for you to think about. Is Christ really God?
Yes.